This is the first lecture in a two-lecture series on the double slit diffraction equation. In this first lecture, I'm going to be proving the equation that predicts the double slit diffraction pattern. And in the second video, I'll be using the equation to solve some problems and give you some examples of how to use it. There's a specific way of observing the effects of diffraction in light by passing the light through a barrier with two slits cut out and observing the pattern the light forms on a second barrier beyond the first. The pattern shows clear maxima, which are points of constructive interference, and minima, which are points of destructive interference. So when light passes through a material with two small openings cut through it, a diffraction pattern appears where the light spreads out in all directions and the two waves of light coming in from the two slits interact with each other in certain ways. There are certain points where those waves constructively interfere to create maxima and certain places where they destructively interfere to create minima. And if we place a barrier a certain distance away from those two openings and observe how the light looks on the barrier, we'll see the pattern that I've put on the right, where you can see there are places where there's a lot of constructive interference, where the light is very bright, and then between those places are points of destructive interference. So you get these points of light separated by points of darkness where the constructive and destructive interference is happening respectively. So in this video, we're going to talk about how to predict exactly how this pattern will look. But before we talk about that, we need to talk about the idea of path difference of waves. The path difference is just the difference in the length of the total path of one of the waves of light and the other. You'll remember that constructive interference occurs when two waves are perfectly in phase, and destructive interference occurs when two waves are perfectly out of phase. So if the crests of one wave line up with the crests of another, the two waves will enter into constructive interference with each other to create a single overall larger wave. And if the crests of one wave line up with the troughs of the other wave, that's when destructive interference occurs and the waves cancel each other out. We can also talk about constructive and destructive interference in terms of the path difference of waves. I'm going to show you how that works. You can see here as an example that these two waves are in constructive interference. I'm going to play that one more time. Because they're lined up in such a way when they're hitting the wall that their crests line up and their troughs line up, these two waves are in constructive interference. And if I look at the difference in their path, I can see that the difference in their path is exactly one full wavelength of the wave. One wave is traveling for one full wavelength longer than the other. So because the difference in their paths is exactly one full wavelength, they line up perfectly to create this constructive interference pattern. We can now try to figure out where the next constructive interference pattern will occur if we change the path difference. So if we make this path longer, I can see that the next place where perfectly constructive interference will occur, right here, is when the path difference is exactly two wavelengths long. And if I do this one more time, I can see that there's one more point that I can find where they constructively interfere. And that's where the path difference is three wavelengths long. So this is proving the rule that says that constructive interference will occur if the path difference is exactly one integer, one regular number, multiplied by the wavelength of light, or n times lambda, n being an integer and lambda being the wavelength. So the only time constructive interference occurs here is when you have a whole number multiplied by the wavelength of path difference. As long as you have that, as long as you have complete wavelengths of path difference, constructive interference is going to occur. So that's where that rule comes from. I can now line these waves up to create perfectly destructive interference. You can see that the crest of one wave perfectly lines up with the trough of the other. So that results in perfectly destructive interference. And this is going to occur if the path difference is exactly an integer plus 0.5 multiplied by the wavelength. So here, I can see that this path difference is exactly half of one full wavelength of the wave, and that's producing destructive interference. If I extend this to the next point where perfectly destructive interference occurs, I can see that the new path length is 1.5 times the wavelength. And if I do that again to the next point where perfectly destructive interference occurs, I can see that that's 2.5 times the wavelength. So the pattern here is that destructive interference will occur for every integer plus 0.5 multiplied by the wavelength. So just looking back here, First integer I'm using is 0, so 0 plus 0.5 is just 0.5 times lambda. And then the next integer is 1, so 1 plus 0.5 is 1.5 lambda. Then going to 2, so the next point of destructive interference occurs at 2.5 times lambda. So if the waves are otherwise perfectly the same, the path difference can tell you whether constructive or destructive interference will occur. In an actual double slit experiment, the two slits are extremely close and the wall the light is projected on is very far away. For the proof of this equation, I'm going to exaggerate the distance between the slits so the proof is easier to visualize. So again, the goal of this equation is to try to predict exactly when constructive interference will occur on the wall. And when that happens, a dot of light appears. When perfectly destructive interference occurs, no light appears. So in an actual experiment, you would see the pattern on the left. And just to make that a little bit clearer, I've made a diagram of what's going on there on the right. Okay, so now let's come up with an equation to predict exactly where each point of constructive interference will occur. Constructive interference is going to occur whenever the path difference is an integer multiplied by the wavelength. So we can try to figure out different points where that will be true. And one point where that will definitely be true is the point on the wall that's in the exact center of the two sources of light. Because at that point, the path difference is just zero. They've both taken the exact same length of path to get to that one point. So if there's no path difference, constructive interference is going to occur, because that's like using the integer zero in the constructive interference equation. And so a point of constructive interference will always appear at the exact midpoint of the two slits in the double slit experiment. So now we need to figure out where the next point of constructive interference will occur and how far away that will be from the center point. That's the goal of this video, to understand exactly where those points will appear. Now that we have that first point of constructive interference, the goal of this video is to understand where the next point of constructive interference is going to occur. That's what the equation does that we're looking to get. So before we do that, I'm just going to define some terms. I'm going to call the distance from the diffraction grating to the wall capital D. I'm going to call the distance between the two slits lowercase d. And I'm going to call the distance between two points of constructive interference S. So to understand where the next point of constructive interference is going to occur, we need to understand the path difference between these two lines. Like how much longer is one line in comparison to another? And one way of finding the path difference is to draw an isosceles triangle over the two paths, because two sides of an isosceles triangle are the same. So if I superimpose this triangle over my system and draw this new green line down here marking off the edge of that triangle, everything past that green line is going to be the path difference between the two beams of light. So in order for that point on the wall to be a point of constructive interference, that path difference length has to be equal to an integer multiplied by the wavelength of light. So again, just a reminder, the reason why we want that path difference to be an integer times lambda is because that is when constructive interference occurs. So as long as that path difference is an integer times lambda, constructive interference will occur on the wall and we will find our next point of constructive interference. I'm going to draw this blue line in the middle just to show the midpoint of the two beams of light. That will come in handy later. And just to visualize what's happening here, if I imagine this beam of light going toward the wall, and I can see I've made it so that the path difference from one beam to the other is exactly one full wavelength, like that green line is marking off exactly one full wavelength of light, perfectly constructive interference occurs at the point of the wall. You can see that two crests are occurring at the exact point of the wall, leading to constructive interference. Let's see if we can find more relationships between these variables. In an actual double slit experiment, the slits are extremely close together compared to the distance to the wall. So because they're extremely close together, that means that the two rays leave the slits at roughly the same angle, because they only need to angle toward each other a tiny little bit over that huge expanse of space in order to eventually meet up at a point on the wall. So for this part of the proof, we're basically going to pretend that those two rays have the exact same angle. And if the two rays are the same angle, the line marking their path difference to the wall makes a 90-degree angle with them. This is because if these two things are effectively the same, we could theoretically just kind of rotate this down like this. Because again, they have the same angle compared to each other, so they could also have an angle of 0 and 0. And it becomes very clear that that green line is making a 90 degree angle with the rays. So we can say that the green line is making an approximately 90 degree angle with the two rays. I'm going to use the angle on the top of this resulting triangle to highlight a relationship where I can see that the path difference is the opposite side of the right triangle, and the space between the slits is the hypotenuse. So I can write an equation that says that sine of that theta, that angle, is equal to the path difference n times lambda over the distance between the slits d. So I'm going to make a note of that and use that later on in this proof. There's a way of proving geometrically that the blue line that I've drawn has the same angle as the green line. I'm going to skip that part of the proof right now just because I do want to get to the main part of the equation. But we can assume that those two angles there are the same. And you'll notice that that blue line is actually the hypotenuse of a right triangle made with S and D as the two bases. You'll notice that the blue line is actually the hypotenuse of a right triangle made with sides S and D as well. So I can define tangent of theta as being equal to S over capital D. Because the difference in the angle between the two beams of light is actually extremely small, the angle in the experiment is also extremely small. This is important because for extremely small angles, sine is approximately equal to tangent, because cosine for very small angles is roughly equal to 1, and tangent is equal to sine over cosine, which here will be about the same as sine over 1. So we can say that sine and tangent are roughly equal for these very small angles, which we're dealing with in this experiment. So that means that the two different equations that we got are actually equal to each other as well. So we can connect them like this and get a single relationship for the distance between constructive interference that has nothing to do with the angle. So what this equation is saying is that the distance between points of constructive interference is equal to the distance from the slits to the wall multiplied by an integer, which just tells you how many points of constructive interference you are away from the center, multiplied by the wavelength of light, divided by the distance between the two slits in the double slit experiment. That's how you prove the double slit equation. In the next video, I'll show you how to use it to solve problems.